Hello, good evening, everyone. I'm Tree Swenson. I'm the executive director at Hugo House, and I'm thrilled to welcome you all tonight. Not only are we lucky enough to all be here to listen to Mary Gaitskill, but this is the first time that Hugo House has had a chance to present in this historic venue, so we're really thrilled to be here. And we're here because the temporary home where we are does not have a space large enough to contain all of us, though our classes are being held there next to our munificent landlord, the Fry Art Museum, and I believe Jeffrey Hirsch, who helped arrange this, I think I saw him earlier. But in the meantime, a permanent home for Hugo House is being built in a multi-use facility back on the location where we were across from Cal Anderson Park. And not everyone knows that it was not our idea to move, but we are enormously grateful to the profound generosity of our founders and early supporters who are making it possible for Hugo House to buy a place in the heart of Capitol Hill. So we still have a long ways to go to accomplish this dream, but and we will be asking you for help, so stay tuned. I do want to take a minute now to lament the fact that that President Trump has suggested the elimination of the National Endowment for the Arts today, along with other important cultural agencies. So I want to urge you all to contact your congressional representatives to let them know that, let them know how important, whatever it is that you want to say, but if the arts are in fact important to you. And it certainly is important to have that funding in order to ensure that there is access for all to the arts. You know, it's one of the first things that dictators do. They subvert the production of art, they attempt to silence the opposition, quash artistic expression, and generally neuter or eliminate the press. And that illustrates pretty precisely why places like Hugo House are important. You know, in the political fury, I think that a lot of people have kind of thought, no, there are more urgent things than writing, but in fact, there really isn't anything more important for writers than to write. Because to honor words and to pay attention to both their precision and their nuances, rather than thinking that a single word is adequate, huge, fake, great, whatever it is, sad. And it's the work of writers to find and reveal the complexities of truth. And of course, we know that truth and facts are not the same thing. Truth is deeper, it's more enduring, and it uncovers and reveals human delusions, including self-deception. So, a place like Hugo House matters more than ever, and we provide a literary hub where writers can tap resources and come together to support each other. I'd like to thank our sponsors of tonight's programs, the now endangered National Endowment for the Arts, Amazon, Arts Fund for Culture, Arts Washington, the Office of Arts and Culture, and our media sponsors, the Strangers A&P and KUOW. They support Hugo House because we are a nonprofit organization. And now I'd like to introduce Peter Mountford. Peter is the events curator at Hugo House, and tonight he is also going to be on stage not only as the MC, but to interview Mary Gaitskill in part two. Peter is himself an accomplished novelist. His first book, A Young Man's Guide to Late Capitalism, won the Washington State Book Award, and The Dismal Science was named as a New York Times editor's book choice, and his books are down here along with Mary Gaitskill, so they will both be signing afterwards. And now I'd like to bring up Peter Mountford.
Thank you, Tree, and thank you all for being here. I'm going to not adjust the mic too much, but a little bit. I'm so glad to see you all here on this beautiful Thursday night in Seattle. And I'm so excited to introduce Mary. So the format is I'm going to introduce her. She's going to talk for 45 minutes or something. And then there will be a short intermission of about 10 minutes where you can get a drink, use one of the restrooms. They're sort of around the place in mysterious places around the building. And then hurry back, because then we'll have a Q&A and there'll be questions from the audience, and it'll be really, I'm really looking forward to that. So I'm reluctant to admit this, but it is the truth that I encountered first Mary Gaitskill's work because I watched the movie Secretary. It's true. Which puts a kind of reassuring, almost pleasant gloss across this array of experiences that's depicted in that film, including the sexual objectification of a young woman by her domineering boss who likes to hike up her skirt and spank her. Then I read the short story that inspired the film, and I don't want to simply say that the story is better, although it is, but specifically that the way it's better than the film is connected to a lot of what makes Mary Gaitskill's writing so wonderful in general. The story is much more complex and unsettling in its exploration of the line between power and vulnerability. The woman in question is disgusted, excited, depressed, numb. She's even liberated. It's terrible, and it's also awakening. And it's this kind of confluence of things that seem incapable of inhabiting the same space, but do nonetheless, that is kind of, I think, for me, the hallmark of a lot of her work. Her characters are often profoundly wounded people, and they're often acting out as well. But she resists explaining their compulsions in hokey psychological parlance. When pressed in a 2011 interview in The New Yorker about a story of hers that they'd recently published to talk about the causes of male compulsion towards violence towards women, she simply refused to play along and said it was intuitive and not rational. But crucially, she didn't just throw up her hands either. Quote, "It's not that there is no explanation, but whatever it is, it's both too deep and too fast-moving to be tracked. It blends with too many other things, the way dreams blend with different things together. People say that if you talk too much about sex, you take away the mystery. I say talk all you want. It isn't listening. You will never take away the mystery." Formally, one of the things that's really drawn me to Gaitskill's work is the deep emotional tones or often alarming bluntness of her characters, or the discomforting sorrow, the profusion of unnamed quantities, but the very unique way she navigates time and space. Maybe it's a bit mechanical, but we are a writing center. And I think it's really amazing the way she does this in her writing. Her novel, Veronica, a National Book Award finalist and a New York Times Best Book of the Year, traverses decades and continents in a single paragraph. You can't identify aspects of it as flashback or backstory because the story lives everywhere. The past is certainly not past. Her stories also have this effect, spanning time and space, almost recklessly burrowing deep within a character's psyche. She published 3 collections of Bad Stories, Bad Behavior, and Don't Cry, and Because They Wanted To, a finalist for the Penn Faulkner Award. Her stories have frequently appeared in The New Yorker, but also Harper's, Esquire, and thrice in Best American Short Stories anthologies, and twice in the O. Henry Prize stories. She's also the author of 2 other novels, 2 Girls, Fat and Thin, and The Mare, a gorgeous book which came out to rhapsodic reviews in 2015. We'll talk about The Mare a bit later during the Q&A, but I just want to read a little from Stacey DeRasmo's superb review in The New York Times. Quote, "The question Gaitskill seems to ask again and again in all of her work and with astonishing force in The Mare is how to feel, how we do feel, not only in spite of damage, but also because of it. how emotional or physical collision with other beings is, in fact, the only way to wake up and become fully alive. If there is an ethics to be teased out of Gaitskill's complex oeuvre, it might be that the only soul-killing mistake a person can make is collapsing into numb self-enclosure. So let's not do that. Okay, everyone, here's Mary Gaitskill. Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks for coming out. I didn't know, Peter, that you first heard about it by watching Secretary. You didn't tell me that. The whole thing with these introductions, they're wonderful, but they're also kind of horrifying, because then you have to come on and be incredibly great. And that's, what if you can't? Anyway, I'll do my best. So, These things, these craft talks, are actually hard, because I think it's hard to talk about writing. I'm not even sure writing should be talked about quite as much as it is. By talk about, I mean analyze it, say why something is great or why it's not, or basically why it's alive or why it's dead. Partly because obviously it's subjective. I'm sure you've all had the experience of reading a dozen rapturous reviews of something, you go out and buy it and you think it's horrible. Or occasionally it happens even the other way around. For some reason you pick up a book that you've read is awful and you like it a lot. Then there's, of course, the more complicated or differently complicated phenomenon of context. Context, both an individual line or individual set of lines might be really ghastly and overwritten in a certain context, but be absolutely great in another context. It's a shameful secret that sometimes writers who teach writing talk about their students. And sometimes what they say is wonderful. They talk about how talented they think somebody is, or the incredible thing somebody wrote that class, or just really how astonished they were by how much potential they think someone has. But then there is the dark side. There are those times when writers quote things that their students have written that pretty much make them fall out of their chair laughing. And one example of one of these unkind quotations was, I remember it, was years ago, "Somewhere inside Joe's head, truth sodomized logic." I thought that was pretty great. But this is a person's, an example, somebody's idea of really bad writing. And it may have been. If it was meant to be really serious, it could have been terrible. But then there's also the broader context, the social context. I used to work at the Strand Bookstore, which is known as a used bookstore, although they sell new books too. But I remember the shelves were just, the used bookshelves were full of books with just all kinds of superlatives blurbed across the front. Pulitzer Prize winners, Nobel Prize winners, National Book Award, no one had heard of them. And sometimes I looked at them, they weren't terrible, but you could see why no one had heard of them. And you could also tell that they very much belonged in a particular context. There had been a kind of perfect storm of a need for a certain type of writing, a certain type of voice, a kind of synchronicity that made this particular book really hit the sweet spot. So all those things are a part of what's confusing and why it's hard to tell sometimes if you're hearing a lot of voices and if the world around you is in the receptive state for something like that. But there's also something else, and that's what I am calling, for perhaps lack of a better word or term, the inner weave of a novel or a piece of short writing. And what I mean by that is the mysterious nature of the life under the story, that for which the plot is basically functioning as a conduit. I'm talking about a kind of unseeable content which might be compared, if you're prone to metaphors, which I am, to a person's unconscious or the guts of the body. You don't see the unconscious, but you do feel it. I'm sure you've all had the experience of knowing someone who seems very friendly and they smile and they have a pleasant voice, but for some reason they make you uncomfortable and you can't put your finger on why it is. Or it may be the reverse, somebody who really acts like a jerk. They're aggressive, they're abrasive, but for some reason you feel good around them. Not to be too painfully topical, but just to give you an idea of what I mean, I have actually heard Donald Trump supporters interviewed say they don't like his personality, they think he's brash, they think he's rude, they're uncomfortable about a lot of things he says, but they voted for him anyway. I don't know what they would say, but it seems like they felt something in him that they responded to, possibly not even quite knowing what it was. But that's a very real thing. And the guts of the body, well, you don't see them, or at least you shouldn't, unless you're a surgeon. But you can feel them if you put your hand on the person. And sometimes you do smell them if you're close enough. And whether you can see them or not, they're holding up the body. If they're not there, the body is dead. I think something like that is very present in the best writing, and it's that inner quality that determines what the work is about as much as the plot, sometimes more so. And what's one of the odd characteristics of this mysterious thing is that I think writers themselves often don't know what it is in their own work. When I first wrote, I never thought about what I was doing in an analytical sense. I do somewhat now, but back then I just didn't occur to me to ask myself why I was doing something in that way. And that was fine until I got published and began to be interviewed, and people would ask me questions about why I'd done certain things, and I often just didn't really know how to answer. I stumbled through as best I could, but it really became problematic when I did a radio show with Michael Silverblatt in LA. It's called Bookworm, you may have listened to it. He's an excellent interviewer, and a pretty excited interviewer. And he asked me questions that I was just unable to answer, and I would be like, and while I was attempting to formulate an answer, he would answer for me. And and I would be like, that's what it was. And then he gave me a tape of the show when it was over, and I took it home and listened to it, and I felt horrible. I thought I sounded like an idiot. And so the next time I was on the show, some years later I wrote another book, I was locked and loaded. I came on there so ready that he had barely finished asking the question before I, boom, I just was like Full Metal Jacket all over him. He didn't have me on for years after that. And when I listened to the tape, I felt good. Until 15 years or so passed, I moved. And like happens when you move, boxes of stuff get unearthed. You find weird things you'd forgotten about. And in it, one of those boxes was those tapes. And I listened to that tape I thought was so great, and I thought, my God, shut up. Motor mouth, you're not saying anything, you're just running your mouth. And I didn't listen to the first one, but it occurred to me that even if perhaps I didn't sound like the smartest person in the world in the first one, that my silence was actually the more intelligent answer, because it did respect the mystery of art. It's a very fine line to tread sometimes, trying to explain things or analyze things and respecting that. And so I tread cautiously here, but I to me, part of how that inner story is conveyed or is revealed, makes itself known, is oddly enough through something that seems very superficial, that is style. We think of style as a superficial thing, and in terms of clothes and hair, it is. It's a good thing, but it is pretty superficial. But in art, it really isn't, I don't think. People often put down writing by saying, oh, it's pretty, or it's got a nice style, but if that's not what I'm talking about. If it's merely pretty, it's not doing what I'm trying to describe. I think that it's the best description I ever heard of style was when I went to school at the University of Michigan, and I was friends with this older man. He was probably only 40, but to me he seemed ancient. And he ran a used bookstore, and the guy did nothing but read. He just sat in his bookstore and read. That's how I got to know him. Every day I would pass the window, and there he'd be, huge Coke bottle glasses strapped on his head, just reading and reading. Finally, I went in and talked to him, and we talked about a lot of things, and we agreed that style was very important. And therefore, I was baffled when he said to me, style is really a byproduct. And I was like, no, a byproduct isn't important at all. And he said, no, what I mean is it's a byproduct of the author moving in a very deliberate, sometimes exploratory way around with each word in order to bring out the shape of whatever he or she is trying to describe, whether it's an object or a person or an emotion or an idea or phenomenon of any kind. That shape that happens is a result of each one of those decisions that are made. And then he went further, he too is fond of metaphor, and said it's like, he had an English accent, it's like a plant, a flower, that when we look at a flower, what we respond to very naturally is the beauty of it, the shape, the color and the smell as well. And he said that when style is working as it should, it's the same relationship to the appearance that a plant has to its genetic makeup. The appearance of the plant is the inevitable byproduct of the internal working of the plant. Now that's a pretty exact connection. I don't know, I'm not sure if any work of writing could be that perfect. But nonetheless, it really stayed with me because it makes sense to me. It's working, it's like it's when it's coming from the inside rather than the other way around. And the element of style that I want to focus on right now is, might be described as a simple word of description or imagery. These are, I think, in much contemporary writings, really sorely underused, and I would say even misunderstood. A lot of people students don't like to write descriptions, people sometimes don't like to read it, but it's not there merely to set a scene or ground you in the character or character's world, though it can certainly do that, and it may be very valuable that way, depending on what you're wanting to write. But it does something else. It can also give words essentially to what is wordless through creating pictures and images that irrationally make a connection to that deeper body of the story or what I'm calling the viscera or unconscious. Writing is a very strange art form because it uses incredibly primitive technology that does not appear to have anything to do with what it is. Like music, I believe, is made up of sounds that originate in the natural world, and painting or sculpture is a physical object. But writing is black and white words on a page. It's these weird little symbols that you see them, if you understand them correctly, incredible stuff springs into your head. It's about words, but paradoxically, the most powerful writing uses these little black and white symbols in such a way that transcend the symbols or words to become something more powerful and more layered and yet also more direct. Writing is very rational. It comes into being through the rational mind, but great writing comes from a much deeper, stranger place, and it's related to the rational mind, but in a way that dreams are related to thought, that's irrationally. Writing is about words, but its most powerful language is the language of images, at least for me. Sometimes these images come into being through metaphor, and sometimes they're just very direct renderings of the extraordinary imagery we are surrounded by in physical life without really even noticing it. It's always fashionable here and there, now and then, to talk in terms of rendering society in the novel. That the novel, at its best, addresses social issues and social institutions. David Simon, who is the creator of The Wire and who I revere, because I loved The Wire and considered it a towering achievement, but he, some years ago, made me and other people a little sad by saying that the modern novel is dead because it focuses on individuals, not social structures. And there is perhaps some merit to this idea. Social structures are huge, and they are fascinating. And they're made up of a lot of individuals, and individuals get chewed up by them. But they exist in a much bigger, much, much weirder world. That being the world we are sitting in right now, the earth, the sky, the ocean. I think there's like headless worms eating sulfur at the bottom of the ocean as we speak. There are creatures living on our eyelashes. There are creatures living in our stomach. There are things happening in the walls around us that we are absolutely oblivious to. I think there's an ant called, I believe it's actually called a fly decapitate, or an ant decapitating fly. It lives in the body of a fly until it's ready, and then it emerges and decapitates the ant and exits. There's a lot more that could be said about flies. We live in an unbelievably strange world. I thought before I came on of a book by Emile Zola, who I don't know how many people read Zola anymore, but he could be he was a great example of a social writer. His books were very much about the world he lived, social struggle, class struggle, social upheaval. One of the most famous ones, the only one I've happened to have read, it was called Nana, which is about a street prostitute who, because of her beauty, ascends through the ranks of society to become the courtesan mistress of one of the most powerful men in France, and becomes a huge celebrity, much like a celebrity might be today. And it's very much concerning social crises of the time. But the thing that I most remember is the beginning when Nana is first introduced. She's performing, she's basically a stripper, although they don't call it that, of course, at the time. She's performing in a sleazy cafe where she doesn't take off all her clothes, but she's practically naked. She's so scantily clad, she's practically naked. She is singing, but that's not the point. And it's very dimly lit, and she's standing in the light, and she raises her arms over her head, and of course she has armpit hair. They didn't shave it then. And there's the description of the sweat clinging to her armpit hair. It's so beautiful and so strange. Like just the mystery of this creature who has so much power and so powerless in this dark, ugly place and is so compelling that she is going to be put into this position of national prominence, and not only because of her looks. So that is, you know, kind of what I'm talking about. Yes, there is the social world, but then there's something else which is even stranger, and the social world is pretty strange as far as I'm concerned. And I guess what moves me most about writing is when we sense part of what I think is often that this hidden subtext is that very mysterious nature of where we are and who we are, and the sense of this small human creature pressed up against this unknowable thing, whether it's a social structure or this really utterly unknowable planet that we live on, or simply the unknowability of our passions, because this very strange natural world, which I hope we are not on the verge of destroying, because it will outlast us even if we kill it for a while, but it is expressing itself through us all the time. And I've gotten a little far afield, perhaps from my craft talk, but I do want to read, so perhaps to bring it down to earth a little bit, or to art a little bit, I would like to read to you some pieces of writing that I hope will illustrate a little what I mean. How many of you have read Pale Fire by Nabokov? I urge everybody to read it. It's in really one of the best books ever. But I'll try to summarize the plot. Say something if I leave something out or forget it, get it wrong. It's supposedly about a man named Charles Kinboat, who, if we are to believe him, is a refugee from his kingdom of Zembla, which he rules with great abandon, but he's had to flee and finds himself living in hiding in this ridiculous New England town, college town. He's teaching at a really Philistine girls' college. The only light of his life, the only thing that makes it any good to him at all, is his neighbor happens to be the poet John Shade, the author of the fabulous poem Pale Fire. And Kinboat is just utterly obsessed with John Shade, in love with him really, and is not able to express his love as he would like because John Shade is happily married. And this is new for him because he in Zembla was able to disport himself in as many ways as he would like, although even he, because of convention, had to get married to a young woman named Disa. Disa, because she's very young, doesn't really understand why he can't consummate the marriage, even though he does try. So she is a very minor character. All of the present time of this story takes place in this New England town, although there are flashbacks to Zembla. But Disa is I would say, a minor character. She comes up a couple of times. And I'm going to read a section about her that happens on page 209. It's approximately 250 pages, a little less, I think. But anyway, here's how he is thinking of her. What had the sentiments he entertained in regard to Disa ever amounted to? Friendly indifference and bleak respect. Not even in the first bloom of their marriage had he felt any tenderness or any excitement. Of pity, of heartache, there could be no question. He was, had always been, casual and heartless. But the heart of his dreaming self, both before and after the rupture, made extraordinary amends. He dreamed of her more often and with incomparably more poignancy than his surface life feelings for her warranted. These dreams occurred when he least thought of her, and worries in no way connected with her assumed her image in the subliminal world as a battle or reform becomes a bird of wonder in a tale for children. These heartrending dreams transformed the drab prose of his feelings for her into strong and strange poetry, subsiding undulations of which would flash and disturb him throughout the day, bringing back the pang and the richness, and then only the pang, and then only its glancing reflection, but not affecting at all his attitude towards the real Disa. Her image as she entered and re-entered his sleep, rising apprehensively from a distant sofa or going in search of the messenger who, they said, had just passed through the draperies, took into account changes of fashion. But the Disa wearing the dress he had seen on her the summer of the glassworks explosion or last Sunday or in any other antechamber of time forever remained exactly as she looked on the day he had first told her he did not love her. That happened during a hopeless trip to Italy in a lakeside hotel garden, one cloudless evening with the mountains of the far shore swimming in a sunset haze and the lake all peach syrup regularly rippled with pale blue and the captions of a newspaper spread flat on the foul bottom near the stone bank, perfectly readable through the shallow diaphanous filth. And because, upon hearing him out, she sank down on the lawn in an impossible posture, examining a grass culm and frowning. He had taken his words back at once. But the shock had fatally starred the mirror, and thenceforth in this dreams, her image was infected with the memory of that confession, as with some disease, or the secret after effects of a surgical operation too intimate to be mentioned. The gist, rather than the actual plot of the dream, was a constant refutation of his not loving her. His dream love for her exceeded in emotional tone, in spiritual passion and depth, anything he had experienced in his surface existence. This love was like an endless wringing of hands, like a blundering of the soul through an infinite maze of hopelessness and remorse. They were, in a sense, amorous dreams, for they were permeated with tenderness, with a longing to sink his head onto her lap and sob away the monstrous past. They brimmed with the awful awareness of her being so young and so helpless. They were purer than his life. What carnal aura there was in them came not from her, but from those with whom he betrayed her. And even so, the sexual scum remained somewhere far above the sunken treasure and was quite unimportant. Now that's a lot of emotion and a lot of words. I mean, relatively not that many, considering the length of the book, but nonetheless, there's a lot in there about a character who's, like I said, pretty minor. And the imagery is extraordinary. The subsiding, soft, undulating, attenuated in shape sentences, and the tone amplified by the meaning of the words, the listless grace of ineffable grief, the blundering of the soul through an infinite maze of hopelessness and remorse, one of the best phrases I've ever read. The rippling water, the subsiding of feeling that gets less and less as it moves further and further away, then returns with this big rush. This extraordinary blend of the mundane and the fantastic, which I find characteristic of his work generally, but it's really strong here. And this delicate quality of something unreachable, of one reality bleeding through another, the peach, the lake all peach syrup regularly rippled with pale blue, and the captions of a newspaper spread flat, perfectly readable through the shallow diaphanous filth, and this sexual scum and underneath the sunken treasure, and this fragile bridge between an imaginary world that is of the dream in which he loves her passionately and the world that actually is, and the tension between those two. This is a great human conundrum, and it's also, for many people, innately erotic. What's hidden is most real, and we will never really see it. And that is what the book is about. And when you read this, you may not really register it as the theme of the book. It doesn't stand out that way. It's not presenting itself that way. But it's very much bleeding through this language. In another example, I might give is from Charles Dickens' Bleak House. How many people have read that? Also really great, very old-fashioned. Hard to read if you don't have a tolerance for old language, but I think it's worth it. The description I'm about to read is a character who would probably not be written today unless something's changed that I'm not aware of. I'm pretty slow moving these days. But her name is Lady Dedlock, and she's one of these Dickensian characters who is declared what she is as soon as she appears. She's proud and she's cold. And she's aristocratic, and she's proud, and she's cold over and over and over again. She's really like a playing card almost. And here is one of the places where she is introduced. She's been introduced before this, but this is following the introduction pretty quickly. My lady Dedlock has returned to her house in town for a few days previous to her departure for Paris, where her ladyship intends to stay some weeks, after which her movements are uncertain. The fashionable intelligence says so for the comfort of the Parisians, and it knows all fashionable things. To know things otherwise were to be unfashionable. My Lady Dedlock has been down at what she calls, in familiar conversation, her place in Lincolnshire. the waters are out in Lincolnshire. An arch of the bridge in the park has been sapped and sopped away. The adjacent low-lying ground for half a mile in breadth is a stagnant river with melancholy trees for islands in it and a surface punctured all over all day long with falling rain. My Lady Dedlock's place has been extremely dreary. The weather for many a day and night has been so wet that the trees seem wet through, and the soft loppings and prunings of the woodman's axe can make no crash or crackle as they fall. The deer, looking soaked, leave quagmires as they, where they pass. The shot of a rifle loses its sharpness in the moist air, and its smoke moves in a tardy little cloud towards the green rise, coppice-topped, that makes a background for the falling rain. The view from my Lady Dedlock's own windows is alternately a lead-colored view and a view in Indian ink. The vases on the stone terrace in the foreground catch the rain all day, and the heavy drops fall, drip, 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 upon the broad flagged pavement called from old time the ghost walk all night. On Sundays, the little church in the park is moldy. The oaken pulpit breaks out in a gold sweat, and there is a general smell and taste as of the ancient dreadlocks in their graves. My Lady Dedlock, who is childless, looking out in the early twilight from her boudoir at a keeper's lodge and seeing the light of a fire upon the latticed panes and smoke rising from the chimney, and a child, chased by a woman, running out into the rain to meet the shining figure of a wrapped-up man coming through the gate, has been put quite out of temper. My Lady Dedlock says she has been bored to death. So if you know the story, that has quite a lot of resonance. Even if you don't, it's could be boring to you if you don't like to hear things being described. But it's, again, it's, she is a figure that she's like a playing card. She's very flat. But this context around her, this imagery around her, makes her something else altogether. She's like symbols clashing, like female symbols of female, like social, social form and social idiocy and this raw female force. She is the whole flavor of this is muffled, drenched in the flavor of death, the fecundity of nature, which is actually in this rather rotten, running together, unpredictably shifting, moving constantly, and smelling of death. And the imagery of her, what she's watching, the woman coming out of her cottage, I think it is, chasing a child, Lady Dedlock is going to be chasing a child in the rain towards the shining figure of a wrapped up man in a very, very different way by the end of the book. And by the end of the book, you won't remember this. This is page 11. This is not meant to foreshadow, or perhaps it is. I don't know. I don't know what Dickens would say. I shouldn't speak for him. But I think even if it is foreshadowing, it's doing something else as well. I don't think it could be foreshadowing because it's so small and so early that I don't think you'd remember it. But it does put an image in your mind, which can, like one of those little things that you used to be able to buy in the back of comic books, this little pellet you drop in the water and it turns into a dragon or something. It does operate a little bit like that in your psyche. And even if it doesn't, it's got that quality of this dense life that's happening in this book populated by these utterly flat characters and this kind of chatty tone, which I read at the beginning about what's fashionable and what isn't. So there's one last thing I would like to read, which is quite different, but I think does something quite similar in that it makes you feel the story in almost bodily way, is the first paragraph of a story named Good Country People, which is by Flannery O'Connor. She does something slightly unusual in this paragraph, where she describes a character who is also a side character. She's an important side character, but she's not the main character. There's basically one main character that's an extremely unhappy young woman named Holga, or Joy, but she's called herself Holga because she hates the name Joy. And she, it's basically her living with her mother in this really tiny rural area, which Joy/Helga is forced to live in because she has an artificial leg and a heart condition. And the neighbor of Joy and Helga is a woman who's basically a tenant farmer named Mrs. Freeman. And the story is not about her in any way, though she figures in it, but Flannery O'Connor chose to open the story with a description of Mrs. Freeman, with a fairly long paragraph considering the length of the story. Besides the neutral expression that she wore when she was alone, let me start that again, I hate to screw up in the middle of a line. Besides the neutral expression that she wore when she was alone, Mrs. Freeman had two others, forward and reverse, that she used for all her human dealings. Her forward expression was steady and driving, like the advance of a heavy truck. Her eyes never swerved left or right, but turned as the story turned, as if they followed a yellow line down the center of it. She seldom used the other expression because it was not often necessary for her to retract a statement. But when she did, her face came to a complete stop. There was an almost imperceptible movement of her black eyes, during which they seemed to be receding. And then the observer would see that Mrs. Freeman, though she might stand there as real as several grain sacks thrown on top of each other, was no longer there in spirit. As for getting anything across to her when this was the case, Mrs. Hopewell had given it up. She might talk her head off. Mrs. Freeman could never be brought to admit herself wrong on any point. She might stand there, and if she could be brought to say anything, it was something like, well, I wouldn't have said it was, and I wouldn't have said it wasn't. Or letting her gaze range over the top kitchen shelf where there was an assortment of dusty bottles, she might remark, I see you in that many of them figs you put up last summer. Now, there is no real reason that we need to know this about Mrs. Freeman. I mean, it does tell you something about the things I described before, about the setting, about the culture of the place, about how people talk. There are people who make jam and put it up on the top shelf, store it, so they might eat it if they need it. There are people for whom grain sacks are a part of life. So those are very practical purposes that it's serving. But it's doing something else that isn't quite so clear. It's giving you a feeling, like what's in the marrow of the story, in a sense. And it's in the language. Steady and driving, advance of a heavy truck. Only two movements possible, forward and reverse. Real as several grain sacks thrown on top of each other. It's very physical, it's heavy, and it's limited, severely trapped. There's no nuance or subtle anything. Anguish for a complex mind, which is what we can intuit in this paragraph. I mean, there's humor in it too, but in Joy Helga, if nothing else, has a sense of humor. But it's like the tone that we're going to be living in this story, and that we're very much going to be experiencing at the end when there isn't much movement possible at all. So I guess this is my craft talk, basically. That it's not, and I don't know if it's really so much craft as it is just a wish or a, not a plea exactly, but a desire for attention to that, these very subtle things that happen in language. They're not even that subtle, really, but it's just they are very much about a feeling quality that isn't about this, about something. It can't be summed up quickly or explained quickly, but in which you feel it more than you understand it in your mind. And I hope you've enjoyed it. And I'll be back and talk to you later.
Hey, okay. Thank you so much. And thank you so much. Another round of applause, please. For... That was great. Okay. I love what you were saying about the interweave, and I know what you mean about this. It's sort of like the way the language is infused with theme, and it's known and not known. And I guess as a process question, I just wondered. If you do it on purpose. Does that make sense? Do you, at some point as a writer, are you aware of yourself creating an interweave, or? Yeah.
Like that?
Down.
Down.
I can.
Like that? Okay. I would say no. Although, the more you become aware of yourself, I mean, like when I said at the beginning, like when I first started writing, I wasn't much conscious of what I was doing. Maybe I simply don't remember right, but mm-hmm. I don't think, I do remember distinctly when people would ask me why I did things, I couldn't really tell them. Mm-hmm. That doesn't necessarily mean I had no idea what I was doing. It means it wasn't about a conscious, real thought out process. I think because I've learned to think in that more rational or analytical way about it, perhaps I'm sometimes aware. I mean, I certainly know what I want to write in terms of action, at least most of the time, although that right. changes sometimes. But I don't really think you can be aware of the other thing. I think it's at least not on the upper level of your personality, but I think it's kind of like the things you convey without intending to.
Right, exactly. Do you find yourself reading reviews and being alarmed and delighted by what you did in your book that you didn't realize you did? Do you have that experience ever? Oh yeah, that was what I was doing. Do you ever have that, or is it not? Doesn't go that far.
Not very often.
No. You gotta get better reviewers. Because I feel like if you don't know, then maybe they'll point it out for you. I wanted to actually talk about your essays. You have a collection of essays with an amazing title called Somebody with a Little Hammer. Somebody with a Little Hammer, as the collection of essays coming out soon in a month or less. And I loved, I've read some of your essays, and I loved in particular The Lost Cat, which is a long and gorgeous essay, which I think is in conversation somehow with the mayor. And I wondered if you could talk a bit about that essay and writing essays, and how about that essay to start with? Your process with it, or?
Do you have a particular question you'd like to ask about it?
I would like to know, I guess, your process with writing that essay, because I found it to be immensely complicated, and do you find that your creative process with it is different than with fiction?
Well, yeah, I think writing essays is, for me, and I would imagine for most people, is really different from writing fiction, because although that essay wasn't typical, I'm going to answer this part of it first. I think that in general, when you're writing an essay, at least when I do, it is pretty clear what you want to do. It is a very rational medium. Mm-hmm. It's generally because you have an argument to make or something that you want to describe, a series of events, say it's a memoir. That Lost Cat was, I would say, a memoir more than an essay. Mm-hmm. And so there's a series of events that I knew I wanted to describe and how I felt about them. And it's not that mysterious, really. It's like, this is what happened. This is what I felt and thought. There are other people involved. This is what I imagine they might have felt and thought. Here's what they said to the best of my memory. An argument, an essay that you're writing to make an argument or to make a point is even more that way. It's like, here's where I'm going. I'm starting from here. I'm heading for there. Boom. Here I go. But fiction just not like that. It sounds ridiculous. I mean, it may sound pretentious to some people, but it truly is an irrational thing. Like when I write fiction, like images come into my head that I sometimes don't even know what they're doing there. like with Lost Cat, it happened because, very simply, I lost my cat. And I was really, really distraught, and I'm not the kind of person who automatically, I love animals, I love cats, they've always been my pets, but I'm not somebody that if my 20-year-old cat dies, I go completely to pieces. I may cry, I may mourn the cat, but I'm not going to lose my mind and stay in bed and cry for days on end. But this was a kitten, and he was sick, and I thought it was partly my fault that he got lost, and I was just astonished at how unglued I became. I was obsessed with trying to find him. I was like out looking for him for actually a year, over a year even, but for the first few weeks I was out every day. I tried flyers up over in every mailbox, on every door for literally miles around, every veterinary. I called every online cat service possible. And partly I just almost couldn't understand what happened to me. It was like I went completely to pieces. There were other things going on in my life that contributed to it. Like sometimes when people read that, they go, what did that cat symbolize? And I'm like, nothing. He was a really great cat. He really was. But there were other things that were also had to do with loss. And I think one of the things I realized that sometimes a relatively small loss can open the door emotionally to other things which you will guard yourself against. You will guard yourself against terrible losses in order to survive. Something I remembered during that time, my father was orphaned when he was quite young. His mother died of tuberculosis, and then his father committed suicide I think it was about a year later, and then he was taken in by an aunt who was married, and her husband drowned. And so he was really surrounded by a lot of loss and death, and it was sort of a family story that he didn't cry until his dog got hit by a car. Mm-hmm. And he went completely to pieces and hid in the closet and cried, and family members thought that was funny. And I was like, I understood it for the first time. It was like, it was the only thing he felt probably that he had left. And also, because it was something he could take in without, I mean, for a little boy, 9 years old, to lose your mother, you don't have a mother, then you don't have a father, then you don't have a surrogate father, you almost can't feel that, or it's going to kill you.
Right.
But the dog, even though you may love the dog very much, is a loss you can take on board.
Right.
And so I felt like almost losing the cat kind of just sort of tore some, it was small enough that I could allow myself to feel it. And it just suddenly opened this floodgate that was partly just had to do with where I was in my life at that time. But I remember pulling over, I was listening to the news, and it was some horrible story that you just would hear constantly then, like you still hear. Some Blackwater contractors in Iraq had just, for some reason, opened fire on a crowd of civilians, and they shot this guy, and his mother got out of the car to try to ran to his body, and they shot her too. And you know, we hear these things all the time, and normally, you know, I think, oh, that's really horrible, but I don't really feel it. And I remember pulling over, I had to pull over because I was so upset, I thought I was going to lose control of the car. And it was very weird to me that this was happening. And so that's why I wrote the essay, to try and describe it. And it became about a lot of other things. So
yeah,
that's how that happened. But even that, which was a very unusual thing for me to write, was a comparatively rational thing compared to a story that I'm writing.
Compared to stories. So do you, I mean, a little bit more process. One thing I was thinking about while you were speaking was this notion that people talk about how what doesn't kill you makes you stronger, and I feel like that's probably bullshit, that actually what doesn't, you know, the scars are not where you're toughest often. I think the scars are where you're weakest, and I wonder if we bear with us, you know, this sort of, we are weak where we've been hurt, actually. And I feel like sometimes your characters feel, you often don't describe specifically the way they are shattered, especially in the short stories. but we can feel, it's, I guess, what you were talking about, the interweave. We can feel the damage that they have sustained without the narrator having to tell us precisely what has occurred. And there's a lot of unspoken qualities in your fiction, huge amounts of information that the reader must infer. And really, and I wonder if, as an author, I guess, do you envision all of the pain and that's sort of being obscured? Because I feel like there's this one line, I mean, you just have a throwaway line in this, it's not a throwaway line, there's a short sort of two sentences in A Dream of Men, also called An Old Virgin, that story in which you mentioned that the character met her best friend in N.A., and that's all we learn about it, about her going to N.A., but it speaks a huge sort of amount of information is within that detail. And I wonder if...
There's a lot of other details in that story that
and
speak a lot.
I know. They're huge. That story in particular is just loaded with... But there's just tons and tons of information packed into small details. And I wonder if when you set out to write, you are just finding those details as you write, or if you have some plan.
I don't honestly remember most of the time.
Mm-hmm.
That particular story... This is really so banal, but that particular story I wrote literally because I had a dream, as I described in it, and everything else just kind of happened around it. But no, I wasn't thinking about the pain of the characters. I was thinking the dream was really beautiful, mm-hmm. and that it described something that I wasn't sure what it was, and I wanted somebody to have that dream.
You write a lot about dreams. There's a lot. I think you have characters dreaming in many, many works, and their dreams show up in your writing. And is that just because you are? You must remember your dreams. Is this a big part of your life, or something?
Not really. It used to be more. I used to have very, very vivid narrative dreams, which I don't that much. I mean, I have them occasionally, but I don't have them as much. I find them. I was mentioning in the class today, it used to be people would tell you, don't write about dreams. Dreams are boring. I don't know if they say that anymore in classes, but it used to be like an article of faith that was just always a terrible idea. And it is sometimes. But I do not find people's dreams boring unless they're, you know, sometimes dreams are just kind of random effluvia of things that collected in your day, and they just kind of are traveling across your unconscious at night having a picnic or something. But dreams, when they're very, they can be very, very expressive. I think they can really be the deeper part of a person talking to that person,
right.
and try, and what they, you may read them completely wrong, but they are talking to you. And it's just, it's interesting to me. To me, saying you shouldn't write about dreams is like saying you shouldn't write about politics. Politics
right.
can be very boring too, but it's there all the time.
And I think that also dreams tend to resist comprehension in a way that I think a lot of, your characters also have a lot of interiority a lot. Like, I think Veronica is a good example of like a book in which, you know, there's so much, the narration is occurring so much inside the mind of the character in a way that is, I think as a writer, I would be terrified to be without the kind of the handrail of such a plot. I mean, The Mare I want to talk about as well, which is a book that has, I think, a more plotted book, but without the handrail of the plot, like I'm terrified. I need like to be strapped into the plot, or I'm terrified. And I wonder if you feel you just stay with the voice of the character, the consciousness of the character, and how you do that sort of inside of the mind of the person is going to be kind of where you reside. I don't know if that's exactly a clear question, but.
It is. I don't think I can answer it, though. But it's funny. I think I'm almost like the reverse.
Right.
Like, plots make me nervous a little bit.
Plots are for dead people, they say.
Well, there's that too, but I don't know why they make me nervous. I guess because I'm fearful of executing them well. Mm-hmm. I don't feel it's my strong suit. I mean, Veronica does have a plot. It's just quite simple in a way. It's both simple and complicated. It's just all in the backstory. I don't find lack of a plot terrifying. I have to feel again that inner propulsion.
Right.
If I don't feel that, like to describe the difference between say the mayor and Lost Cat, they weren't really in dialogue. Lost Cat happened first. I wasn't intending to write a novel when I wrote it. But the mayor was almost came to me like against my better judgment. I was. In one way, it was the most ordinary thing in the world. I was at a rooming house. I taught at Syracuse, and I had to live in a rooming house because I was staying overnight from where I lived. And the woman, really nice woman, who ran the rooming house, had the TV on all the time in the kitchen. And I would get up in the morning and make my coffee, and there it would be. And one morning, it was National Velvet, Liz Taylor, riding across a beautiful Technicolor meadow. And I thought, wow, I wish somebody would make a movie like that about a Latina girl and a horse. Just because this girl I knew who was a Dominican girl who loved horses, and she would have just loved to have seen that movie. And it's kind of a long, boring story, but I did think I can't do that because I don't write movies, but maybe I could write a treatment and someone else could write the movie. I tried to convince my film agent of this, and he said nobody buys treatments anymore. Because that used to happen, apparently. You could write a treatment, someone might actually purchase the treatment, and then someone else would make the movie. But apparently not anymore. So I did write a treatment anyway. It was 30 pages long, and the film agent was like, no, this would never work. This doesn't know if it wants to be a Walt Disney story or a gritty urban story. And I said, well, maybe it wants to be both. And he said, well, if you want that to happen, you need to write a young adult novel. This was back in 2007. And I was like, well, I can't do that. So I just dropped the idea. But it just, I kept getting these pictures in my head, completely unasked for. I decided I did not want to do it. But I would be like at the grocery store, waiting for a delayed airplane or something like that, when I would just get these pictures of this girl and the horse, and dialogue would just come into my mind. And I mean, they weren't mystical images. They were very clear pictures of her trying to ride the horse, falling off the horse, talking to the horse. It was the weirdest thing. It had never happened to me. And I just tried to ignore it. It kept happening for years. And so finally, 2009, I decided to try to write the book.
Yeah, it's an extraordinary book. I mean, I love that the horse sort of responds. There's dialogue. It's not a talking horse, but they have dialogue. And I think it's the way that humans have dialogue, unspoken dialogue. I mean, she's speaking. Velvet is speaking. The character's Velvet, and she's speaking to the horse, and the horse responds in a sense without words, but they have this true relationship. It's a very, very well-formed relationship.
I had that experience with the horse, by the way, which I would never have thought was possible, because I'm not a horse person.
It felt very lived in. Yeah, the horse felt very lived. Was that a similar horse, the one you had?
No, I would never get near a horse like that. I'd be afraid of it. I'm not a horse person. I had to learn how to ride and to basically handle horses simply because I didn't intend to do it, but I realized at a certain point that I had to do it in order to write the book because I couldn't get that information by interviewing people, which I actually tried to do. I went with a notebook to a horse stable and was like, can I ask you some questions? And what does it feel like to have a relationship with it? I realized this just didn't work.
Is it difficult riding a horse? Yes. It was difficult that day riding the horse. Yeah.
So I did it, and I did not actually work with difficult horses. I was afraid of them, which I didn't even know until I started working with them. But they're not, you know, most of the horses that I was working with were not dangerous, but just that they're dangerous in a way any large, unpredictable animal can be, especially if you don't know how to relate to them. But I did fall in love with this horse. There's this one guy. And I remember somebody saying to me, if this book is going to work, you're going to have to come to love horses the way you love cats. And I said, I hope not, because I don't think it's going to happen. I like them. They're beautiful. I respect them very much. But I do not love them. I can't see that happening.
But you did love this one horse.
Yeah, he was really wonderful.
Huh.
And I do think he understood what I said to him, and I thought I understood what he was feeling.
The
novel, I did not feel that way about most of them.
With the other ones? Yeah. It tells of, I think a lot of reviews pointed out that it's very different from a lot of your other writing. It's very short chapters, alternating points of view. To my mind, the central character is Velvet, who's this young girl, who's a fresh air fund kid from Brooklyn who goes upstate to stay with this well-to-do family, this couple, and specifically the woman, Ginger, who's a sort of middle-aged, lapsed painter, and her marriage is like this. I think as a writer, it would be terrifying to write from the perspective of Velvet, who's Dominican, she's a kid, she's very different from myself. The book is so amazing. She feels totally real. And I guess, she was cooking inside of you for years before you started writing, in a way, the character?
No, I didn't. In a way, she must have been. I did feel what you're talking about. I didn't feel, I wouldn't say terror, but I felt a lack of confidence.
Right.
And definitely anxiety about trying to represent that character. A lot of it was simply because of my age, but of course it was because of my ethnicity and class. The question in my mind wasn't should I, it was can I?
Right.
And I remember I was expressing this worry to a friend of mine, and she said, "Oh, Mary, stop it. You're talking about her like she's from outer space. She's a girl.
Yeah.
You're not a girl now, but you were one."
Yeah.
And I said, "Yeah, but she's not going to use, her experience is different from mine. She's coming from a really different place. She would use different language." Again, the thing of style, very important.
Right.
How people use language is extremely important, and that comes out in dialogue. Very different to say yes than it is to say yeah. Or yeah. It's a totally different, it's a different word. So I thought, and I'm not gonna try to write like Juno Diaz in Grief and Wondrous Life, that would be absurd. I was worried about it, and I wouldn't have done it had not these pictures kept popping into my head with such insistency.
Mm.
And I finally thought, all right, because I was also working on another book at the time, and I thought I can't stand it anymore. I'm going to try to do this. So I did.
Oh, I wanted to make room for questions for the audience. If people have questions, please raise your hand and yell them very loudly. You have a question.
How might one access the essay?
Oh, it was in Granta, wasn't it?
It's in Granta, but it's also about to come out in the...
In the book.
The heretofore mentioned Little Hammer.
April 4th, I think?
Yeah.
I have the pub date in my memory. Yeah.
It is in Granta. I rewrote it a little just because I thought some of the language in the Granta version was borderline hysterical. It's basically the same essay. I didn't rewrite it, but there's... Wait for the book.
And there's many other essays in the book, too, so, yeah. So if there's actually a microphone there, too, if people want to take to the microphone to ask a question, if anyone has a question, or I can just keep going. Oh, there's a question coming. Yay.
Hello. First, I just want to say about a decade ago, I'm kind of nervous, you're one of my heroes. I heard you say turn frustration into material.
What?
I heard you say a long time ago, turn frustration into material. And I want to say thank you for saying that. It was some random literary arts fair outside Paris.
I'm sorry, I'm probably hard of hearing. I still don't, something is immaterial?
You shared with the audience, turn frustration into material.
Turn frustration into material? turn, yeah, frustration into material? Does that?
Oh. Yeah, that sounds like something I would say.
Anywho, I'm so glad you said it. It's been really important for my own writing sense. Different topic. I'm curious if there's anything in your process with this book, with the previous one, that you feel has shifted in this new chapter.
The merit as opposed to the other books I've written? Well, they're all a little bit different, I think, but the mirror was different in terms of what I experienced while I was writing it. It's hard for me to put my finger on what it was. It was very much more action driven or plot driven. So right away that makes it different. How could I put that into words? In some ways, I wasn't being as perfectionistic about everything being perfect because I couldn't. It was just not possible. I didn't feel that I could describe certain things with perfect accuracy. Not that I can, nobody's perfect, but in my other stories, and perhaps Veronica, I was really honed in on describing things as closely to perfect as I could get them. There were moments of the mirror when I was like that, but it was not my main feeling. I was more wanting to open up like a broader current and just kind of let something hammer through it. That's the best I can do to describing that.
Do you feel tempted to do more of that sort of more plotted, like where you've mapped out the events and you have to jump through them to an extent?
I don't know.
No?
I don't know. Maybe. Yeah. But it really depends on what the story is. Some things really have to be written that way, and other things really don't.
That makes sense. Other questions? There's one coming.
So when you were talking about sort of style and in a way how it can almost be interpreted as superficial, I was thinking a lot about specifically Henry James, The Ambassadors. And I don't know if you've read it, but Strether, the sort of narrative consciousness in the book, is constantly talking about impressions. And so he's back in Europe and he's traveling there, and everything he sees creates these enormous internal impressions. And it made me think a lot about your writing in the sense that it seems like there's this huge contradiction in subjectivity where each person has this depthless internal experience, but everything outside of us is external. And we can only sort of feel it through the kind of confluence of signs that we have around us. And I even think about a story like A Dream of Men. I believe that was actually the title, and I'm not saying that incorrectly.
It was, yeah.
And sort of narrative consciousness when she's in the doctor's office and there's the sort of gruff man, but she senses the sort of tenderness or something underneath him, some other internal quality, and sort of how even through style or sort of through description, you can hint at the internality of things that can only be addressed from the external. I don't know if any of that made sense, but for me, there were sort of some thoughts I had. But specifically my question for you, oftentimes, when I think about your writing, I think specifically about tenderness, and tenderness sort of in the definition of something that's tender and hurts and is bruised, but also tenderness as the act or state of being tender and acknowledging pain or, you know, something that hurts and is tender itself. So I was going to ask you, who are authors or particular works that are tender to you or you would characterize as tender?
Well, people don't think of him this way, but I think Nabokov is capable of great tenderness. What I just read actually is, I mean, unfortunately for him, there's a little, often a little kind of gloating, sadistic tone to his tenderness, but still, it's there. I'm so sorry I can't answer this question better. This always happens to me when people ask me. I'm really sorry to say I haven't read The Ambassadors. But when you were describing it, I thought of Proust. Mm-hmm. That's very much what he's doing, is just constantly registering the storm of impressions of people and things that happen, conversation that happens. Mm. I know there are people. Willa Cather. She's not read very much now, but very, very capable of tender feeling. I'm tempted to say Alice Munro, but she's so there's so much clarity, and it's a kind of a limpid mental beauty that's more brisk and practical in some ways. Although she's very respectful of tender feeling, but it's not the same thing.
Yeah.
Damn it. Does anybody else think of it?
Well, thank you. I appreciate it.
No, there must be. This always happens. You know, Dickens. Mm-hmm. Again, he's kind of bloated a little bit. Mm. There's a lot of, although I don't think he's as sentimental as people believe him to be. I think people sometimes confuse sentimentality. Oh, you know, Chekhov. Mm. Oh, yeah. Very much so.
Yeah.
But Dickens too. I mean, he can be overblown in his characterizations, but I do think there's genuine tenderness there.
Yeah.
Virginia Woolf, no, perhaps not. Gogol, no. Dostoevsky. Some people probably would think so, though. Mm. Maybe with him in moments. Flaubert. Not so much. Oh, Tolstoy. Mm. There must be someone, though. Purely anybody? Okay, well.
Well, thank you.
Maybe I must do it. Maybe this is my job going forward.
You're the most tender, the tenderest. Thank you.
Tolstoy, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Anna Karenina. Is there another question? We have time for one more. One more question. No? Oh, we have one more. Yeah, Mary.
Perhaps a little of both. I intended from the beginning for it to be two points of view. I didn't think I could do the entire thing from Velvet's point of view. I thought I could do it if I split it between her and Ginger, who's the white woman character. I thought that's how I could successfully do the story. But I didn't intend to do more than them. But as it went on, I just had sort of impossible urges to Paul, Ginger's husband, came in because I felt he was kind of like a reality check in a way that Ginger herself would not be. That's a cheesy expression, but he would see things that Ginger herself, and he would note, he would comment on things Ginger herself would never comment on. And then I thought, okay, it's them. And then, almost against my better judgment, Velvet's mother appeared, and then Velvet's brother, and though they're more in the background. It is mostly Velvet and Ginger. Yeah.
Well, thank you so much. Wait, there's a question. She's urgently.
Who? Orhan Pamuk?
Yeah.
Oh, you're right. Yeah, and he's not American. Yeah, no, not. I'm saying perhaps because precisely, I don't think we're a very tender culture. We're very violent. I'm not sure we know how to be anymore. I think we mistake manipulation and essentially cynicism for goodness. Mm. I'm not sure we know what it is anymore, really. That's a horrible thing to say. And I hope that I'm wrong. Anyway, I hate to end on that note, but thank you.
Thank you.